Good morning, my name is Rahul Menon, and I'll be talking about predicting prediction. So my research question was, how will the growth of big data affect how we react to our world? So let's break this down. What is big data, and why do we care about it? Well, big data, as the name suggests, is the collection of large amounts of data and its subsequent analysis, and which usually leads to a conclusion. And these conclusions usually take the form of a trend, a pattern, or association which wasn't inherently obvious to us before. Because of this, it's extremely useful in the business world. And as it becomes more popular, it's also becoming more prevalent in our world. And we as a society have to be able to understand how we are willing to change in order to fit this trend. And so what is the connection to the stimulus here? Well, so the most obvious connection is with the extrasensory source, because the extrasensory source is all about using sensors and data in order to make a change in our world. This is directly connected to big data because we use sensors and data in order to perform an analysis and make a judgment. This is also connected to Muslim women in a more abstract way. In the Muslim Women article, we learned how we as Americans are unable to make sound judgments about how Muslim women in Afghanistan should be treated simply because we don't have enough information about how they want to be treated. This is very similar to how in big data, if you don't have enough information, if your data isn't applicable enough, you aren't able to make an accurate prediction. And finally, the strongest connection is with the olfactory source. Because in the olfactory source is an exploration of how the brain takes various chemicals from the air and interprets them as smells. And this is a very complicated process which takes a lot of information and boils it down to something very simple, such as a smell. This is very, very similar to how big data works because we take a whole bunch of data and boil it down to a single prediction. So how will our society change? We'll be able to shift from responsive action towards proactive action, especially in sectors such as healthcare and industry. So how will we see this in health? I want you to think for a minute about what is it like when you go to the doctor. You're probably thinking something along the lines of you're sick, you go to the doctor gives you some medicine, and hopefully feel better in a few days. But what if it wasn't like this? What if instead you went to the doctor when you weren't sick, and the doctor gave you medicine so that you stayed not sick? Well, this is how big data prediction works. This man is Edward Jenner, the inventor of the smallpox vaccine. And Edward Jenner definitely did not have access to big data, because he lived in the 1800s and was a country doctor in England. He created the vaccine based on his own observations and own analysis on the fact that people who were exposed to cowpox were often immune to smallpox, and so he started inoculating people with cowpox, and thus the vaccine itself was born. He was able to make such a huge medical breakthrough with only his own resources and his own mind. Now imagine if someone had access to some of the world's leading medical research teams and some of the world's fastest computers. Well, this is exactly what's happening. Apple has teamed up with the Stanford University School of Medicine in an attempt to use the Apple Watch's heart rate sensor to predict and treat heart problems before they even occur. In fact, this is a quote from Lloyd Minor, the dean of the Stanford University School of Medicine, where he's talking about how they're hoping to use heart rate sensing in the Apple Watch to make a shift from responsive healthcare and reactive healthcare towards proactive healthcare, where the patient doesn't even have to become sick in the first place. In fact, the Apple Watch itself has proven itself useful in this proactive healthcare department already. According to the Cardiogram founder, Brandon Ballinger, the Apple Watch can be used to predict with an 85% certainty whether or not a person has diabetes. And so, because of the obvious health benefits, this is only going to continue. As we are able to more and more accurately treat and predict diseases before they become an issue, it's only going to become more popular. And we can also see this sort of pattern in industry. In industry, companies usually create product in response to a potential consumer demand. This is sort of risky, because if you overproduce product, then you're left with a bunch of surplus that no one's going to buy. But if you underproduce product, then you're left with a bunch of unhappy customers that people might not come back to. Big data is a solution for this. Companies such as Boeing have recently implemented a system called just-in-time manufacturing, or just-in-time inventory, which allows them to use data from within their own factories and from airline companies that tells them when they should order parts and when the airline companies are likely to need planes. This makes a more cost-effective manufacturing system because they don't have to waste money on extra parts they don't need, and they don't have to make planes when they're not in demand. Another huge problem in industry is machine failure. Machine failure is very costly for businesses because it not only does it cost companies in repair and replacement fees, but it also stops production for a while, meaning that they are just producing less product over a certain amount of time, and time is money in the business world. Again, big data has a solution for this. Using sensors, similar to those in the extrasensory article that were used for building management, we can use data from these sensors in order to not only detect, but also predict problems before they occur. This is very, very good news for companies because it means that they'll be able to perform maintenance on their machinery rather than actually having to repair or replace them. This is also good because it means that they will have to spend less time repairing them and they'll have more uptime in their production workflow. In fact, this system is already being put into place. GE, which manufactures aircraft engines, has been putting sensors into their aircraft engines for the past few years. These sensors allow them to monitor the aircraft engines while they're even in flight. This means that a GE technician can see that, oh, this certain aircraft engine on this certain flight looks like it will be needing maintenance soon. So they can contact the airport where the flight is supposed to land and have a maintenance crew ready for them on the ground before the flight has even arrived. And this is very good for both the aircraft company and for the passengers on board, because for the aircraft company, it means they'll have to pay less money in repairing their engines or performing unnecessary replacements of their engines. But for the passengers themselves, it also means that because the engines are being monitored and checked more frequently, it means that they have a safer flight. And so, like anything, this shift from reactive to proactive action has some limitations. And so the first major limitation is misprediction. Obviously, if we predict something incorrectly, if our data isn't sufficient, if our analysis doesn't work correctly, if someone uses analysis incorrectly, then we will still have to resort to reacting to whatever problem happens. We obviously can't predict human error, and so if something like that happens, we still have to react rather than we won't be able to prevent. And the second major problem is the misuse of data. So companies such as Amazon and YouTube often collect large amounts of data on individuals in order to further their own businesses. And because of this, there are large amounts of data on individuals that you don't really want getting out into the internet, such as your search history or like what products you put on Amazon, what videos you watch on YouTube, and they use this to give you recommendations, but you don't want like everyone on the internet knowing this. This is private information, and so there are valid privacy concerns that need to be taken into account when successfully implementing any sort of big data concept. And so, what does this mean? Well, the big data shift is inevitable. It's already happening, but what really matters is, as a society, what are we going to do about it? We are going to be able to change from reacting to things to be able to predict and prevent them from happening in the first place. This means that not only will we be able to have a more successful industrial sector, we'll also be healthier lifestyles and be more open to sensors in our everyday lives, which leads to the implementation of the big data software in almost every single aspect of our lives. Thank you.
Okay. So, how did your conclusion respond to any other research or sources that you examined?
So my conclusion is really a compilation of sort of things that I've researched, because most of the research that I did was into separate little aspects of big data and how it affects like small industries, such as for example, the Apple Watch example, right? Not everyone has an Apple Watch, but we can use that to extrapolate that sensors such as that will be able to help us in our healthcare lifestyles and therefore make our lives as a whole healthier.
Okay, so when you started your research, what did you need to know before you could even start? Like, what did you need to find out?
So I basically need to figure out how big data works, how popular it is, and most importantly, like how it's used. Because most of my presentation relies on the usage of big data and how it affects us as a society. And if we don't know how big data is used in the first place, we can't make any sound judgments about what we're going to do as a people.